It's still going?
Yeah, it's still going.
Nah, we just got to get in trouble.
Yo, check me out. Last time.
Okay.
I was a football player.
Okay.
But now I can rhyme.
Okay.
I was talking about what I wanted to study, like Jeffrey Dimes.
Hey, they call me DG because I'm throwing dimes.
Okay.
Hold up. Shot clock. It got time.
Shot clock. It got time.
Okay.
I don't like my chips, but I like a little bit of lime.
What's good, everybody? I'm Nick Anderson. I play receiver at Oklahoma, and I'm a freshman, and this is...
I'm Kaden Helms. I'm a tight end here at Oklahoma, and I'm a freshman as well.
And welcome to our podcast. It's our very first episode. We're excited, and we have our good friend, and also from the 22 class, Grayson Halton, otherwise known as G-Baby, joining us today. And we're excited, and I hope you enjoy.
But also, we need y'all to help us out with something, okay?
Yes, I forgot
to mention. So being the first episode, we haven't really worked out all the kinks yet. So we kind of need y'all to help us, you know, with the little name. I know my teammate, Braden Willis, he got a podcast. It's called Pod on the Prairie. You can check that out if you want. But
free plug.
Something kind of along those lines, something kind of like, you know, that just rolls off the tongue good.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Just rolls nice. We just need something. Just drop it in the comments if you have any suggestions. And thank you.
Yeah.
All right. We have G Baby here, otherwise known as Grayson. But just introduce yourself.
Yo, my name is G Baby. They call me Grayson. I'm from San Diego, California, and I play football at the University of Oklahoma.
That's it. Well, how'd you grow up playing football? Like, what really got you into it?
I mean, I started playing flag football when I was like 5-6 years old.
Okay.
And then they started off, it's called Mighty Might, and that's where it's like your first year of pads.
Okay.
And then I started with a Fazzo. After that, I mean,
did you understand what you was doing? Because I know when I had my pads on for the first time, I was like running the opposite direction.
Bro, I ain't gonna lie, bro. Like, tackle, bro.
Tackle is crazy.
Yeah, tackle is crazy. Like when I first like put the pants on and the pads,
yeah,
I was really just running everywhere. Like I couldn't even control myself, man.
Yeah, like, just like running like a bobblehead.
Like a bobblehead, bro.
I already know what you mean.
I had to get used to it. And I remember when I first got them on, bro, my dad like made me run, like do a whole workout with them on.
The whole pads, pants,
helmet, jersey, shoulder pads. I don't know, it was crazy.
Bro. I ain't gonna lie. Did y'all go through like the high top stage with cleats, bro?
Oh, of course. I had the Cam Newton's.
I had white and black ones.
I had the black and the Under Armour was white. I had the black and the black and blue ones.
Yeah.
Like I was on the Panthers or something.
It was either black and another color.
Nah. You say you played tackle?
Yeah, they had me playing tackle. Like, so y'all had like things called like stripers, right?
Stripers.
Oh, you didn't?
What is
stripers? So like, there's like a weight limit for who could carry the ball.
Oh, who could carry the ball, bro. They did that. When I went to a tournament in Vegas, they did that, and I was too heavy. And they gave me a wrist. Or no, they put like an X on my helmet, like letting them know that like I can't run the ball.
So like, yeah. So basically, if you're a striper, it means you can't like carry the ball. Like you're too heavy.
Yeah.
And so I was tall. But
that boy was 200 at the age of 5.
Yeah, I was considered a striper. I was considered a striper in my own age group because I was just so tall. So I had to like play up. But like before I started playing up, like when I just played my weight group, I was a striper, so they had me on the line. But then when I moved up, they still had me playing tackle, but they had like this play where like it was like a tackle around. I got the ball, bro.
Tackle around is crazy.
I would pull and they would just hand it off to me. I would just run, bro. And then I scored off of it. And then they moved me to fullback. I don't know why fullback.
Because he was big.
And then, listen. So they moved me to fullback. And then first play at fullback, I get the ball and I score like a 70-yard touchdown.
Fullback is crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy.
Then they moved me to running back. And then I was doing my thing there. And then I moved to I moved everywhere. I was quarterback for a little bit. Yeah. Diversity, you know what I'm saying?
I mean, I feel like, bro, like, I played running back my whole, like, years.
You played running back?
Bro, I was tough, but I was, what?
The jumbo.
Like Jerome Bettis.
The bus is crazy.
I'm like 6 years old, bro, running dudes over. But I feel like I got ran over lots of times when I started Mighty Mind. I feel like that's what really like brought me out. Cause I mean, some guys like will play like to the basketball players, you know.
You know
how that goes. You're not really ready for it. You get hit once and then they done.
You really find out if you bet for football when you line up on that Oklahoma drill.
I almost went to baseball.
I thought I was a hooper.
A couple times, I dreaded coming to practice because I was like, I don't want to go to football, bro.
I got to hit somebody.
That's like the age of y'all just be tackling the whole practice,
I thought my life was hard going to elementary school. all these seven hour days, coming out of work, it was tough.
You got practice right after. Go home, go change real quick, and gotta go to practice.
Man, we thought we had it tough.
You had no say, bro. When the coach told you to run, you had to run.
I cannot be the only one that on the way to practice in the little white Suburban, y'all was bumping that Black Eyed Peas. Please tell me your mom was on that Black
Eyed Peas. I used to hit that boom, boom, boom.
Let me hear that. I used to listen to
the radio in San Diego. That was a vibe.
Yeah, nah, definitely. So when you first got here,
yeah,
you were playing, what were you playing originally? Was it nose or D-tackle?
No, I was playing, when I first got here, yeah, I was playing D-tackle.
Okay.
And then they moved me to end.
Was it because of the injuries that we've had at the spot?
So
or then was once, just because Coach saw something made you a D?
I guess, but I mean, I feel like I could do a little something, but
you definitely diversity. Doing a little something. Yeah, I mean, we see it on Saturdays. Just talk about like what the change has been like for you, like learning, was it different, were the plays a little bit different, like moving from D-tackle to the end, or?
Yeah, I mean, that's like real life knowledge right there, because you got to know like what to do on both sides of the ball.
Definitely.
So like on different sides. So like say you're into the field, you got to know what to do, and then away from the field, you got to know what to do. So you got to really be in your playbook and knowing what to do. And I feel like that's what I got to get better at. You know, once that clicks, you know, I'll be on the field like more than I have been.
Yeah.
But I ain't gonna say it's been difficult, but it has been a challenge, because like first I come in and I'm trying to learn all these deep tackle plays, and then boom, oh, you're playing end this week, going to practice Monday, playing end, learn these plays. So then I try to get down the end plays, not trying to forget the D tackle plays, because I had a feeling they was gonna move me back.
Exactly.
You know?
It makes you more versatile.
Yeah, exactly. So once they moved me back, I was like, oh, now I gotta get back to the D tackle plays. Yep. I feel like overall, like the playbook, that's really determined if you're gonna get on the field or not.
Yeah. Speaking about the playbook, sorry. How is Coach Venable's defense different than a high school defense that you came from? Because I know for me, trying to learn Coach Lebby's offense, man, coming from a high school offense is so difficult.
I feel like, bro, BV, he adjusts to what the offense is doing. So, like, in high school, we just really ran one defense, and I was like a 3-2 or a 3-4, 4-3, you know, four down linemen, three linebackers. Mm-hmm. But I feel like with BV, he's changing it up. So, like, Cyclone, we have one D tackle and two ends, or either you're just four down with four D linemen. So I feel like that's what really empowers his game, because like he knows what he's talking about, and then if we need to make a change, he's gonna make that change into a different formation.
Yeah, no, definitely. That's hard to game plan against if your defense just adapts to the offensive scheme.
Yeah,
yeah. I feel like speaking on like learning the playbook, I feel like the 22 class, like once we all like get the playbook down, we're gonna be so tough, bro. I feel like we got so many dudes, bro.
I feel like people don't even know, bro, because they just looking at like this team, and it's like, yo, y'all forgot his first recruiting class, who he recruited.
Yeah,
like are we some dogs for real?
Because we was really in like middle ground of like in between when Lincoln left and then when BB got in.
Yeah, but let's just say we all didn't know where we were going to go.
I remember right when I figured out that Lincoln left, I was like, dang, what am I doing now? Like, I remember I was sitting in my living room like with my dad, just like, do I decommit? Do I look for other schools, like other opportunities? I remember he was like, well, like I think it was a couple of nights after, he was just like, well, they got some promising head coach options. I think if Coach Venables gets in there, then you might have to stay. Like he's a really
good. Yeah, I feel like that was what set, like, literally I heard like all around, like everybody wanted BV. Nate wanted Venables. Yeah.
And then when BV brought in Coach Levy, it was almost like a done deal, seeing how effective
that old man's
offense was.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and then did they come to your house after or did BB come to your house?
Honestly, it was a weird process for me because like I was committed to Oregon.
We both were
actually. Yeah, we were committed to Oregon. So once I found out Crystal Ball left, you know, I put on Twitter like, oh, the news. Everybody heard the news, wondering where I was going. So at that point, I didn't know where I was going. I feel like once I put it on Twitter, that's when different coaches start texting me and everything. Hey, what's up? What are you doing? How you feel in this process? Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But BV, you know, I just got a text out of nowhere. I don't know how he got my number, yo. Like, I don't know how he got my number.
You know he got those connections.
Yeah, man. He just sent a picture. He was like, hey, it's Brent Venables from University of Oklahoma. How about I want you to get up here? Call me soon. So I called him, and then we talked, chopped it up. He was cool vibes. And then I started getting on the phone with Coach Chavis. You know, that boy.
That's probably one of my favorite coaches.
That's my dog right there. Him and Coach Bass.
Coach Bass,
them are guys. So once I first, like, got on FaceTime with him, it clicked. Like, he was being all goofy with me. Like, he just talked to me.
Yeah.
Like, he knew me my whole life. So I was like, yo, like, I'm going to go rock with it. I'm going to go up there and visit. And then once I came up here, I was like, oh, yeah.
Like, this is a spot.
Yeah, I'm rocking with it for sure.
Like, I think literally, like, I think it was a day after he got hired. Like, he literally, like, flew down to Nebraska, and he was at my high school. He, like, had me bring my family. Like, had me bring my high school coach, too.
Yeah.
And we was just, like, chopping it up in, like, my study hall, bro. I was like, dang, like... Like, this is Brent Venables right here. Like,
yeah.
No, for real.
That's a crazy
feeling. Yeah, it was crazy.
Like, I remember when he came down to my high school, it was, like, right after practice, and he went to my he was already at my parents' house, and I came home, and I was like, they didn't tell me anything because I usually have my phone shut off. I think it was actually dead, and I came home, walked into the living room, it was just Brent Venables on my couch. I'm like, oh, shoot, like, I still need to get a shower.
My mind right. It's hard to you.
Nah, for real. But it was cool. Like, just instantly, like, hit it off. Like, just a real, genuine guy. Like, I know, like, some players I've talked to have said, like, yeah, once you get to campus, like, you're not going to see the head coach at all. Like once you get there, like, you're probably never going to talk to him again. But, like, I see PV almost every day.
We see him every day. Like, he wants us as close as possible.
Yeah, no, he really does. He speaks on that family aspect.
Literally, that's his main thing. Like,
yeah, and he really lives by that. Like, it's crazy.
Day by day.
Yeah. But kind of like your first, because you got here in June, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so kind of like your first, I don't know, month or so, like, how was it, like, acclimating? Because I know you're from Cali.
Yeah,
from
San Diego. Believe me or not, I passed out the first week of workouts.
I wasn't even talking about the workout.
Yeah. Hey, that's what came to mind.
Passed out?
Yeah, them quads.
How did I forget about that?
Yeah.
I did not know you passed out.
We are in different groups, though. You passed out?
Chris Watson. He's not Chris.
Bro,
he's not here now. You got to give us a story.
Give us a rundown. You got to
give us a story.
So, you know, just in case y'all don't know, Thursdays is conditioning days.
Tuesdays were the quad days.
Tuesdays and Thursdays.
Yeah.
Okay, so Thursday, I knew it was that last day of that week.
Yes.
And we all go all out. Like, we know it's the weekend coming up, so we finna go push this, get this over with.
Yep.
Boom. This is my first week, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm trying to go beat everybody, you know, trying to prove myself. Like, I can work with y'all.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I didn't mess up, bro. I ain't gonna lie, bro. I didn't know what I was getting myself into.
Yeah, you bit off a little while you could chew that moment, huh?
Yeah, so it's about 10 o'clock. You know, we got workouts. It's about 115 degrees outside.
Nah, it was so hot.
We just get done with, I remember that week. That week was
crazy. Yeah, we just get done with lifts, and then now it's time to go to the field. So we got quads. Run four quads. Run them quads, man.
For the audience, if you don't know what quads are, quads. I don't know if I should explain the gist, but it's just down and backs that are timed, and then a shuttle that is timed, but it's a 60-yard shuttle. So it's 60 yards total.
15 down
and
back.
And it's all timed. And if you don't make your times, you have to come back with the next group and do the whole workout again.
Yo.
So you don't want to miss your times.
Literally.
And,
and that's about 16 seconds.
Yeah, man. Like you don't have a lot of time.
Yeah, and the thing about like G-Babe, like the summer group that came in, so like me and Nick were early grads, so we came here in January. So like we already went through winter workouts, spring ball, all that conditioning stuff. So like we were already kind of like acclimated like the running and stuff. And I think we had like done quads even like before
y'all got here. We definitely practiced.
But like one thing I'll say about quads is they do not – like they get easier, but once they get easier, the coach is like up how many we have. And y'all like the mid or not the mid year, the summer guys that came in, they came in like a period when we was up in like how many quads we had. So y'all got the worst of it, I ain't gonna lie.
Y'all didn't have the last day.
Because we was running two.
Yeah, bro, the last day we did six.
Yeah.
We did do six.
We did
bro.
Six, man.
I was in the best shape of my life.
I had to be to get through that.
Yeah.
But like back to it, it's time to bring it up. After we run quads, you know, everybody breathing. And, you know, Smitty is talking.
Hands off your knees. Hands off knees.
Once you hear that hand down, you better get your mind right.
It's not no hand down, pause, like get ready, go. No, it's
hand down, go.
And if you don't put your hand down, like if you a second off putting your head down, nope, next group, go. Y'all coming back, 3 o'clock.
Coming back.
Like, oh my gosh, calm down.
Yeah, so Smitty start talking, and I don't know, bro, I just looked at the sky, fam. I just felt something like, I just felt tired. Like, I didn't know what, I was tired, like literally tired. And then all I just kept on blinking, bro. And the next
day, one blink was a little bit too long.
Too long, fam. Woke up in an ice bath.
Nah, that's
wait,
crazy.
You didn't even like, so you just woke up and you're like, where am I?
Nah, not even where am I. Like, I'm just in the ice bath. I'm just like,
that's crazy.
Type, like, I knew what happened.
The ice bath,
but I just
didn't
know what happened. Like, literally. And then Chris Watts, he's like, oh, you passed out.
Dang, bro.
The ice bath must feel good, though.
Yeah,
had to.
Heck yeah. Real good.
Nah, but there was like a day, like, some people had to come back to like, so I was in the first group. I was in the 6 a.m. Some people had to come back from my group, go to the 8 a.m.
Yeah.
And then the thing about like the summer workouts was like, if you met, there was like some days where like if you messed up, then like just you would go to the next group. But there were some days where like, if a couple people mess up in the group, the whole group would have to like,
all of us
have to go to the other group. So there was a day where some people in my group had to go to the 6 a.m. group, then they went to the 8 a.m. group, and then the 8 a.m. group had like multiple people that messed up. So that group had to go to the 10 a.m. group. So there's some people that had to do 3 rounds of quads in one day.
I'm not gonna lie. That is crazy. Wild. I could not
wake up.
3 rounds of quads? Nah. I barely make it through one.
Did you even make it?
You said what?
Wait, I don't even think I'm gonna make it.
You think you'll make it to the first one?
No. First one's
cool. Yeah. I ain't gonna lie. Once you get about like
that three marker.
You start feeling it.
You start feeling it.
And then they'd be like, come on, hey. I said 16, but I really want 15.
Yeah, because when 15. That's the thing though. When he said, so we have like a time to make it. And if he say 16 seconds, he really mean 14, bro.
Yeah. And sometimes, bro, don't let Smitty count because he going to be 1, 8, 9. Yeah.
Oh, me, bro. I know he be skipping numbers. I heard him one time. I'm like, yo, what?
Nah. We was just in 5. Why are 12. Why are we at 12?
Then we got to go +2.
Oh, yeah, +2.
Oh, my God.
And everything we do. Literally everything.
+2 yards and everything you do.
Don't even go to the line, man. Go past the line.
Yeah, don't risk it.
All that stuff helped, though. I ain't gonna lie. Like, helped so much.
Oh,
like,
thanks.
I didn't even, like, it you translates. Got into, yeah, I didn't even know, like, Smitty took me to some places I didn't even know I could go, bro.
Bro, like, I was just gonna say that, bro. Like, my mindset, that's literally what he puts me on. Like, just my mindset, knowing, like, oh, you gotta do this, bro. Like,
yes.
You have no choice.
Yes.
It's either you wanna do this or you going back home.
Yeah.
I have a pretty, like, long story. It's not that long. I'll make it shorter. But when I first got here in the winter, it was January, my first workout, we don't talk about this a lot.
First workout goes.
But nah, the first workout, I jumped up in the air.
And we're doing like combine stuff, like testing. Calm down.
We don't have to explain the whole story, okay? But yeah, I jumped in the air, came down on my wrist, had to get surgery, tore a ligament. But I was out for a little bit because I wasn't able to sweat after the surgery. But then once I got my hard cast, they threw me right back into workouts. And we were doing speed school, and he was introducing speed school to us. When I tell you, that man pushed me to my limits.
I feel like speed school wasn't even that hard, though.
No. It wasn't hard because y'all were, like, gradually introduced to... I was in the middle of that.
Yeah, just to, like, explain what speed school is. So, like, it's really just, like, constant running, really, but, like, we...
And it's, like, different, like, movements, yeah, like,
so, like, we'll mix in, like, different levels of, like, how fast you run. And this is, like, all the skills. I think the bigs did, like, sleds or something.
Yeah.
But, like, so, it's really just a bunch of speed work getting you faster, but it's just, like, constant, like,
There's no breaks, constant movement. Yeah. And so, I'm in my cast out there thinking, oh, this don't seem too hard. I'm straight. Bro, we get done with the first high knees. Like, we're still warming up. And
I can't make it.
We have seven more workouts to do. And I'm just breathing hard on the high knees. Bro, when we got to the spins where you have to run run 10 yards, spin to the right, run 10 more yards, spin to the left. I tried to spin it to the right, bro. I tripped, fell right on my face, yeah, bro.
I know how.
And then the trainer's like, is your wrist okay? Like, oh my gosh, we should have done. I'm like, I'm fine. I'm just trying to focus on my breathing right now. Like, I'm about to pass out. Like, you know, G-Baby over here.
Me, nah. I would have been like, no.
Nah,
get me out.
Look, G-Baby didn't even get the experience of coaching stations, bro.
Oh my god,
the winter coaching stations?
Nah, hey, I'm not going to lie. If I didn't have my cast, I would have died on the coaching stations because it saved me from a couple of the workouts y'all was doing. I'm not gonna lie, y'all had like six stations. I did,
yeah,
like,
well, coach, my head, like, three. Hurt. Bro, my wrist, coach.
I'm talking about coaching stations might have been harder than summertime. I ain't gonna lie. I think they're harder than quads. I'm not gonna lie.
Harder than quads?
Because listen. So basically, coaching stations, it's just a bunch of stations and you just have different, like, agility drills and, like, basically just football implemented stuff that you have to do in each drill with the coaches. But, like, we're all on a timer. So I think each station is like 4 minutes or something, or three minutes.
Like that. The longest 3 to 4 minutes you've ever experienced.
So it's like 3 to 4 minutes of just straight, like, whatever drill the coaches have for you, you're doing it for 3 to 4 minutes straight.
Yeah.
And then you'll hear a horn and you'll go to the next station. I think it's like, it's a cool amount of stations. I ain't gonna lie. It literally fills the whole entire indoor.
I'm pretty sure, like, it's like six.
No, it's more than six because it fills the whole indoor, like, because
they have like the mad drills.
I think I know what y'all talking about. Remember at the end of we did that at the end of
yeah we did, but that was like a it was a like lesson down version of it.
It might be seven because it's one in the middle of the
field. Yeah, them
so basically
hard.
Like, I knew it was bad when we walked into the indoor and they had trash cans laid out all around the indoor for people to throw up
there. Oh, yeah.
Like, they was, like, expecting, like, us to get to that point.
And I'm glad they did because everybody was throwing
up. Yeah.
Everybody was lie.
Not me, though. I'm still clean. You know, knock on wood.
But you have to balance it, though, because if you drink too much water, game over. You have to, like, sip. But, like, at the same time, you want to chug it because, like...
But the real thing is, like...
You're going through it. Like, you need some agua.
Also... If you have one of them, so they give out these, like, jerseys for, like, you're grouped up in however many groups there are, like, however many stations there are, there's that many groups, and each group has, like, a captain. So if you're the captain of your group, they give you, like, a red jersey, and you have to lead all the drills, like, go first in all of them.
Oh, no.
If you have that, You better be ready, bro. Like, yeah,
because like ready. Being at the front of the line, you might go like two or three times. Where like if somebody's in the middle to the back, they go like twice at the max.
Yeah,
and then like right when that horn blow, you have to run like to the next station, like in the middle, and then break down and like do the little chop. Nah, man. I remember.
Yeah, won't catch me being a leader.
Nah, they so give it out. They give it out.
They give it. You don't got a choice. Yes. You got no choice.
Nah, it's low key. It's like an honor thing though. Like if they give it to you, they really think you like. Yeah, yeah, good,
though. Hey, they trust you.
Yeah. That'll be fun though.
Got to live up to it.
Little work.
All right, G baby. I know Cali got all the nice cuisines and places to eat. Where do you? Let me phrase this differently. What's the best spot in your opinion in Oklahoma that you've been to so far?
In Oklahoma?
Yes, to eat anything.
Are you talking about Norman or Oklahoma City?
Anything. Oklahoma in general.
Bro, I've been to this spot, Pearls. It's called Pearls in Oklahoma City. Yeah, bro. Me and my mom, my brother, and I went a couple other times too. But
what type of food is it?
All right, let me tell you, bro. So I got my appetizer. That's crab cake. Crab cake, good boy. Look like this. Chunky.
Crab in Oklahoma?
Crab cake.
We a little far from the border now.
All right, don't say that. Well, I'm eating. Don't know what I'm eating now. But yeah, I had some crab cake, man. That was good.
Yeah.
And then I had some shrimp and sausage grits. And they just put their little sauce on the top.
Hold on.
Make my mouth water when I talk. You know what I'm saying? Like, bro, it was good.
Nice stuff.
You know, I rock with it. So, Pearls, Oklahoma City. Yeah, they like, look hungry.
What would you say yours is, Nick?
Dang, I don't know.
You got to go with Ted's? Ted's Wings?
Nah, I can't. Ooh. Yup. Yup, Tez, for sure. There's a little soul food place called Tez Wings.
We got him a slide. Bro, I haven't been there.
It's in OKC, too. It's a little bit outside. I think it's like 30 minutes away. But, bro, when I tell you it's the best wings I ever had, my brother put me on because my brother went here.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. And they're building one in Norman, too.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to open up
soon. That's a must.
I'm going to be there every day.
Oh, of course.
You can put money on that.
I need to try that.
Man.
I know you think it.
What about you, Kaden? It's not like, because listen, you know me, like, I don't really like to, like, go out and, like, sit down a lot, bro. Like, yeah. I just like to get my food,
and go back to the crib.
Go to the crib and just sleep for real, or, like, hop in the game.
Yes. So, I have to fight this man to go and eat somewhere, like, nice.
So, I just be eating, like, Chick-fil-A and Cane's a lot, but the one place that I eat at, like, it's pretty much the only place I'll sit down and eat at is Louie's. I ain't gonna lie.
Louie's
is fire.
The wings.
And it's right on the corner, too.
Wings are convenient. Yeah. But I'm telling you right now, he didn't eat with me when I went to Tez, bro.
If you
eat those wings, it'll ruin Louie's wings for you, bro. I'm telling you right now. Like, you won't even eat them the same. You'll be like, dang, these are good, but...
Bro, they better
Tez.
They better start building Tez in Norman, Oklahoma.
And they got to speed it up. I'll help them.
They're going to build the world's biggest canes, like, on
I
the corner.
Did, I forgot that they said something about that. Was that real?
I don't know.
What you rank Canes out of 10?
Out of 10?
What about this? Canes or Chick-fil-A?
Chick-fil-A, easy, and I'm going to explain why.
Nah, Chick-fil-A, yeah.
I'm going to explain why right now.
And I'm going to make it. The chicken at
Canes is not that good. It is mid. No. I'm standing by this.
Listen,
that chicken is mid. The only reason Canes is relevant is the Canes sauce.
Okay.
And maybe the Texas toast, because the Texas toast is best.
All right. Now you're true. That's true. But, like, you got to think of it, though.
Think of what?
I don't even know, but Cane's is just fire the sauce.
And the fries be soggy when you take them out the box.
No. If you leave them in there.
The drive back to the house is, like, 10 minutes tops. And then, like, by that time, it's, like, soggy and...
For here to go. For here, please.
Okay. You see, it don't work for them. You always got to go back and chill.
Chick-fil-A on top. And here's why. Listen. They got variety to their menu, all right? Cane's, you can get what?
Chicken.
A box combo, a caniac, the three finger, and then a sandwich.
It's like four things on the menu. It's just different numbers of chicken.
It's the same thing, just less tenders, or more chicken.
And then there's like a sandwich, which is just chicken tenders with bread.
But the thing that sells me on Chick-fil-A you know, I'm on my weight gain stuff. I got to get the milkshake.
Come on,
yeah. And the frosted the lemonade. Ooh.
The milkshake is fire.
Right, frosted lemonade might be the best thing ever.
I'm going to be alone in this, but you just reminded me, Whataburger is on top.
Yo,
I'm sorry.
No,
listen.
Whataburger's
no, listen. Now, now, now we having no. A Whataburger's argument.
On top. And listen, because I don't think
y'all say Whataburger's better than In-N-Out, and I'm not gonna lie.
I haven't eaten that Whataburger in a while because they took away my favorite sandwich. It was a Buffalo Ranch chicken strip sandwich. But with that, I think they're on top. I ate there almost every day, and the fries.
Your sandwich's not there no more.
You said what? Nah, they'll fix it for me. If I got to talk to somebody, I'll talk to the manager if I got to.
I'm already know.
Goated. And you had a bad experience with the milkshake. Because I feel like if the milkshake was good, you'd still mess with Whataburger.
I ain't gonna lie, I'm never eating that Whataburger again.
So,
bro, listen.
Whataburger In-N-Out.
I've never had In-N-Out. Oh, I've had Whataburger, and it is probably it's not.
I need to get some In-N-Out in Norman.
I've had In-N-Out. It was a while ago.
Listen,
but I had
yeah, it. Yeah, did you really have it though? Did you really have animal fries?
Animal fries.
Style. Yeah, you ain't hear about that.
I didn't hear about no animal fries.
You ain't hear about it. You gotta come down to Cali.
Bro, I ain't gonna lie. I feel like Whataburger just don't care about their food, bro.
Bro, listen,
I feel like they
you
be
gotta
making
find,
that stuff too fast.
You gotta find a Whataburger that has that passion.
The one in Norman, though. I ain't gonna lie. The one in Norman, dude. I had a milkshake and had me on my bathroom floor like this.
I'm not gonna lie. He was on that crazy for a minute.
I was for real thought I was gonna die, bro. Like, I got food poisoning, bro. I was like, nah, I can't hear you, man, bro. Because I always
catch me at Whataburger.
I always gotta have a milkshake with my meals. I was like, okay, cool. I've never had a milkshake from Whataburger.
Yeah.
Never again.
Jeez. Get a little patty melt. That's all I get.
Patty
melt's
got it.
Patty melt with bacon.
Bro, but if you ever, because it's a limited edition sandwich. And it wasn't before. It was like the workers knew what you wanted. And I would always get it. But then they put it on the menu and they took it off. And now they won't fix it for me anymore.
Yeah, it's not there no more.
But why are we arguing? I got a would you rather question.
Right, babe.
That it started in high school. I made it up in high school, and everybody was arguing with me about it. But I think the answer is pretty clear.
All right.
So, would you rather have two frogs randomly placed on this earth that are chasing you down? They always know where you are, and they cannot be stopped, and they're indestructible. All that. And if they touch you, you die.
Ooh.
Or fight a bear once a year with nothing but a slingshot.
Ooh.
Now, what am I going to do with a slingshot?
Slingshot's hard now.
I put a rock.
Slingshot's. You have a year to train. And every year you get better and better.
Okay, true.
You feel me?
I might. I see you talking about.
But the frogs, like.
Nah, if they.
You can just constantly move. But like,
and they just constantly after
they
you.
They constantly after you.
For like,
and listen, they start at random spots on this earth, so they could be hella far.
It could be anywhere.
But once they get to you, like,
it's over.
And like, you can't just be relaxed.
No.
So they can like,
or you gotta
go through
fight.
Walls.
They
or
could
like,
be, yeah, they would be no, behind yeah, you right yeah, there. Listen,
I was thinking about like, well, what if you just put them in a box? But like, that's why I said they cannot be stopped. So even if you put them in a box, they're gonna find a way out.
Yeah.
Okay. Listen, I think I'm
gonna just get the bear, bro. Cause I know what's coming after me. I know it's gonna be a bear.
Yeah.
I know what I'm gonna have to do.
Yeah. But if you miss that shot, dog, like if you miss your shots,
I'm running. Rocks in my pocket.
I'm running.
I have a couple more rocks.
Yeah, you have rocks for sure.
What's plan B?
But that bear coming. That bear coming.
Nah, I ain't gonna lie. Cause listen,
slingshot,
it's once a year. You gotta fight a bear.
A year's a long time.
I'm preparing that whole year to fight one bear for one moment of my life. I'm preparing the whole year.
The whole year.
Yeah,
that's all you need.
I'm about to come in there, you know, Smitty built. Like,
Smitty built.
If my slingshot miss, I'm about to.
Yeah, you Smitty built. Like, you with your bare hands. That's
crazy. Smitty built. You think you can fight a bear with your bare hands?
To the death,
bear is going to, like, try to kill you. It's kill or be killed. You think you can fight a bear?
I ain't gonna lie.
Hand combat him, right?
That would be my last resort, but I'm saying, like, if I prepared all year to fight this bear.
Like, all year.
Like, I'm gonna have some sort of fighting chance. But the frogs, like.
Like, if David could kill Goliath through one rock.
I gotta say.
Exactly. Like,
come on.
But you gotta believe in that.
But everybody in high school is clowning on me, like, bro. you should do, you should, like, it, oh, the frogs, you just move. But, like, bro, right. like, you constantly thinking about these frogs.
Because listen, though, y'all ain't even think about this. Once the frogs find you, they found you, bro.
Yeah,
like,
you're done. Can't, like, you're done.
Like,
a bear. You playing hide and go seek with them, but they know you at.
Yeah, they
and, like,
know
if
you
they
at.
Catch you sleeping, come on.
Yeah. Because, like, once they start off, like, anywhere in the world, it's, like, cool.
Yeah.
Like, once they find you, it's, like, every day.
But
at
the same time, it's almost like there's one frog. Because, like, when they meet up to find you, it's they're going to take the same amount of time to get you.
So the date to fight the bear will be on New Year's Eve?
All right. I'm going to change. I'm going to say New Year's Eve. just whenever, like, a random.
But, like, you, like, know the date?
It's a set date.
Yeah.
I got to go bear. I ain't gonna lie.
Yeah, I'm going with them.
And you didn't specify the slingshot. I can have, like, a...
I did not specify the slingshot. I did not specify.
I got
slingshot.
You, bro.
In my mind, I was thinking like David Goliath, like swinging a little.
If I miss, I'm seeing God.
Nah, I'm
because the bear.
I mean, either way.
Yeah, yeah, I'm not gonna lie. I took the bear too, just because, like, I don't want to live in fear. I'd rather have, like, a set day that I know I'm finna fight this bear.
Exactly.
And that's a flex.
And, like, prepared.
Yeah, I've got to. Why you work out so much? I gotta fight a bear.
Boy, yeah, and then you know how when people be getting hurt, they be talking about, oh, I fought a bear, like,
yeah,
like they make up some, like, yeah.
But, and low key, like, you can probably make some, like,
what's your job
off that?
Bro, I fight bears.
Yeah,
you that's probably make some. Be like, yeah, like, all right, like, y'all can record me. I gotta fight a bear. Yeah, like, I'm cold with a slingshot.
Yeah, for sure,
for sure.
Yeah, I ain't
glad y'all got any other, like, would you rather's?
Because
that was one I had already thought of.
I haven't really thought of would you rather.
All right, well, if y'all don't got anything else, then do you have any tips for student athletes that want to play college football? Like, any tips at all, whether it's, like, academically or on the football field, in the meetings?
Well, like, I'll go first as far as academics.
Yeah.
One thing I'll say is, like, something people don't really realize when they come to college, like, playing a sport is, like, or at least for here, like, BV says it all the time, the number one goal is to graduate. So, like, school, like, I feel like people say school comes before sports in high school and stuff, but they don't really take it serious. Like, it's just, like, a cliche saying.
Yeah.
But, like, in college, like, school really does come before sports, because, like, if you're not doing good in the classroom, then you're not going – you might not be eligible to play, for one. But also, the coach is going to see that and be like, well, okay, so, look, he doesn't care about school.
Yeah.
So he's not going to know it. He's not going to care enough about, you know, football and his job and his assignments to execute what he has to do on the field, too. So I feel like school is more important than anything, for real.
Yeah, and that's a big point that, like you said, Coach BV says every day the number one goal is to graduate. And if you're not performing in the classroom, then he's definitely not going to let you perform under the lights.
Thanks.
And they stand by that. They're not going to be like one of those coaches that just – oh, we can make an exception, or, like, let's do this and find a loophole. Like, nah, they're going to stand by their word.
Yeah, and it's like that saying, whatever happens in the dark comes out in the light.
Exactly.
It's like, whatever the work you're putting in, that's going to show when all eyes is on you. And that's game time. So either if you're off the field and you're really good, why are you off the field? Oh, maybe my grades are bad.
Yeah.
Maybe I'm not attending meetings. So one thing I'll say is just be responsible and be accountable. I mean, BV stressed that word, being accountable, and that's really what it is to life.
Yeah.
Knowing that you have to go to a meeting, knowing you have this work to do, knowing you have, like, just to practice, watch film, like, just taking accountable, being mature to do, like, what you need to do. And I feel like that's the main thing of this life and in college, just doing what you need to do and knowing wrong from right. If you take care of that, if you take care of the little things, you'll be fine.
Yeah, definitely.
I would say as far as, like...
But, like, oh, yeah. Not
on the field.
One thing, yo. Like, my bad.
Nah, you can go. Yeah.
Like, it's not easy.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people come in. Like, you seen the walk-on. You probably thought... like, oh, I'm finna go in here. I've been playing football since I was...
I was the dude in high school.
I just didn't get a scholarship.
Nah, like, it's really, like, it's a mental game.
Yeah,
like,
for sure.
If you're not mentally prepared and if you're not ready, like, literally to devote your life to this game, then... you're not going to make it past the first month.
Yeah, and one thing I didn't even realize was, like, because I had teammates that, like, went, you know, D1 for football or for sports in general.
Yeah.
And they're, like, telling me, they're, like, Caden, like, this life is like busy. Like you really gotta, like you gotta love your sport to do this. And no, I was just like, at the time I was just an immature like high school kid. I was just like, yeah, yeah. You're like, just saying that. Like I just saw like the flashing lights and like the uniforms and you know Saturdays really touchdowns. Yeah. But like one thing is like we're really like busy from. Shoot, breakfast started 7 a.m. and then you know I got like night classes too. Yep, so my day, I'm really doing stuff from 7 a.m. to 8:30 p.m. every day, just constant, like maybe like an hour break in between.
Crazy. And yeah, I feel like that's what people have to understand. Cause like you know, I have family calling my phone, you know, and I just don't have time to talk. Either I don't have the time to talk, or I'm just like tired and I'm just exhausted. Don't want to talk.
Yeah.
So I feel like you're going to be busy for sure. Like, it's not easy. It's definitely hard, but it's not something, like, you can't overcome, you know?
Yeah.
Definitely. It's going to be – that's what life comes with, challenges. And I feel like this is what we are just going through, you know? And eventually it's going to get easier and easier. We're going to have the same schedule every day. We're going to get used to it.
And, like, the staff, like, make sure that we have, like, a smooth ride, not an easy ride, but like a smooth ride. Like they put everything in front of us. We just gotta do it.
Yeah, sure. They follow really, the schedule basically.
Yeah, like because that's one thing too. Like the first couple weeks you're here, especially as a freshman, like you don't really have a routine down. You kind of like it's like a foreign place. Like you don't really know like where you at. But like I feel like once you get a like good routine down. And, like, the staff really helps us with that, too. Like, they, you know, Teamworks got our schedule all laid out. And
I would die without Teamworks.
Yeah, I ain't gonna lie, I would, too. But, like, once you get that schedule or that routine down, like, it's really easy after that. I ain't gonna lie.
Yeah.
Or easier, I should say. And then as far as, like, on-the-field stuff, for advice, I would just say, like, really just learn that playbook before anything because –
Playbook's important.
You can be as big as you are, you know, as strong as you are, as fast as you are, but if you don't know the playbook, ultimately you're not going to hit the field. Like,
and technique.
And then, technique. Like, the playbook's one thing, and then technique is the other thing. Like, for me, like, playing tight end, I played tight end in high school, but I was really mainly just, like, a big receiver. Like, I lined up at slot outside. I was in line for some stuff a little bit, but not too much. So, like, the biggest thing for me coming to college was just learning, like, really how to play tight end because, you know, I'd never really put my hand in the dirt like that or nothing, you know, nothing really, like, true tight end based.
Yeah.
And, it was really just learning the details. Once I got that or once I'm starting to get that down, I've been doing better, so.
Yeah, I also think a good tip for new student athletes is just, I know in high school, like, if you were that dude or, you know, you might not – do a whole bunch of special teams or like you might just return some kicks or punts. But in college, like that could really be the determining factor. Like if you travel with the team or not, it's just special teams alone. Cause you might be like the third string as a freshman or whatever you are. But if you're not a valuable asset on special teams, then you're not coming with the team.
Yeah, exactly.
It's cutthroat. But you really just have to have passion because special teams, all that is just the want to.
Yeah,
like coach always be saying you gotta have a bad case of the ones, and it's kind of corny. It's kind of corny.
I'm dying right now. Hold up. All right.
So but he just says Coach BB always says that you just gotta have a bad case of the ones, and that's really all it is. Like they'll have receivers that have never even been on the line before, like on the line and punt team playing right tackle, like blocking for a little bit and then going. Like it's really just like. That was a change for me, really.
Yeah, for
like,
sure.
I really just described myself, but it was crazy.
I feel like another thing is just be ready for whatever what happens.
Yeah.
You know, wherever they put you at, just be ready for it.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of things that you'll do that you never even would have thought. Like you play wide receiver next team, you're over there playing tight end or you're tight end playing linebacker.
Yeah, exactly.
Or, you know, so just be prepared for whatever happens. Just go 100% wherever they put you at.
Yeah, like you really just got to embrace your role.
Literally.
And the coaches will see that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, just be versatile.
Yeah, exactly. All right. We talked a little bit about Schmitty, but y'all got any Schmitty stories specifically? Ooh. I'll give y'all some time to think while I share mine. But before the games, we'll be in the locker room, and I haven't been playing a whole lot because of a reoccurring injury, but I'll just be sitting there in my locker room just watching everybody get ready because I like to observe if I'm not getting ready myself. And I see Smitty creep in from the side. First time I saw him, I was like, what is this dude doing, bro? And he was shaking something in his hand. I was like, oh no, what are you about to do, bro? Comes up behind Eric Gray, puts his hand up in his nose. He had smelling salts.
Oh.
Hit him. It was unexpected. Just hit him right in the nose. He was like, ooh, it just started going crazy, screaming and stuff. Yeah. I was like, yeah, there you go.
That's how it really is.
It was funny though. It was funny. That's probably my funniest
Smitty. I just feel like the first day I got here, I got yelled at by Smitty, and I never got yelled at ever again after that.
Yeah.
Like, that literally was the lock in. You can't play around here. Like, literally lock in.
Nah, I feel like mine. So, like, yeah, we have the med ball throws.
Oh.
And.
So basically,
the med ball throws, you have a certain amount of throws you have to do, like overhead med balls, and you're tossing it to a partner.
Yeah.
But like the thing with Smitty, if you mess up, no matter if you're one away from the goal or whether you just started, like the whole group's restarting. Yeah. So we were going to, it was like when we were deep in our like winter workouts. So we were going to like 50. I think we got like the most we did was like 75 or something.
Yeah.
But so we were going to like 50. And we're passing the ball. And something I didn't realize is like the more you pass the ball, the sweatier your hands get. Oh, and like the harder it gets to catch the ball.
Yes.
So like we're going. And like next thing you know, you just hear, Stop.
No.
I was like, we were going to 50. We were at like 42, bro. And we just hear, stop. And I was like, bro, like, what just happened? And I look over and like three people, like the ball just slipped out of their hands, like landed behind them, bro. Like at the same time. And we were all just so hurt, bro. And he was like,
cramping.
Stomach cramping. He was like, this is what he really hits you with the, all right, man. Once he hits you with that, you know it's raps.
That's PTSD.
He was like, all right, man, back from the top. So we started doing it again, bro. Well, thankfully, the second time we got it, but
that's why you
got
to do it right the first time. Because they make you do it all over again.
Every time I see somebody drop the ball, my heart just drops. Even if it's not for me.
Like, literally, just, like, oh,
I just be scared for them.
Like, y'all got to start over.
Crazy.
Something I didn't even know. Like, me and Smitty both from Nebraska. Bro.
From Nebraska?
Yeah, he from Nebraska. He from, like, more western Nebraska. I'm from more eastern Nebraska. But,
okay. Dang, that's crazy. Something have in common. So, I just want to talk a little bit about this past week, you know, coming off the three losses. It was hard for the locker room. I don't know if y'all had to have noticed. Yeah. Just like the different moods or messages that were kind of being said around the locker room and in the staff meetings and stuff. But what was the main message that y'all remember from that week? That week going into Kansas. That was just like the main message or the main statement that y'all remembered vividly that really helped y'all like get locked in and get focused.
That main message was, don't worry about what those other people are thinking about us.
Mm-hmm.
We know what's going on. We can fix it. Never give up. And I feel like that was one of the main things because
all the critics.
When we lost, everybody just turned their back against us. You know, like, who's this team? Who's this coach? Is he doing it right? Are we doing it right?
Yeah.
And we knew we've been working ever since summertime.
Yeah.
So we knew like it was the small things we needed to get right to just make it click like that, you know?
Yeah.
But, you know, that was just adversity that hit and we just had to overcome adversity, really.
Yeah. I remember just what stuck with me was the BV said, we just got to focus on getting better. every practice, every second of the day, just getting better in whatever you're doing. And that really stuck with me, because even though I'm not playing, like, there's still stuff I can get better in, like better in the training room, get better in the classroom, like everything, like you said, like how you do anything is how you do everything. So really just everything is accumulated into why we were, where we were stuttering and, you know, driving in the mud.
Yeah. The thing that stuck out to me, you know, Coach Lebby was just like, we got to stay like this. Yeah. Like, just stay with your brothers. You know, we going to have each other's backs.
Regardless. You know,
through thick and thin. And then, sorry, man, this cough. But, and then one thing, even BB said before the game, he was just like, let them feel your pain. And that was something that, like, I feel like we all could kind of relate to, because, you know, being Oklahoma, having all these wins through the past couple years, and then having a new coaching change, and, you know, all this stuff kind of being new to us.
It was a shock for sure.
And then, obviously, you know, losing the three games. you know, it was hard, but, you know, I feel like we did let them feel our pain that game. Yeah, for sure. It worked out.
Do you like water or something?
Yeah, it's G-Rate.
Yeah, because it's G-Rate. I know practice for me in high school was just, it was just like, we do like our little team stuff, or we do our position stuff first. We do like our routes, blah, blah, blah. We do a little bit of like routes on air, one-on-one sometimes. And then we'd hit our team stuff. And then we'd have like a long break, like while the other like the twos were going or whatever. And then, like, we'd be back up going again. But I never got, like, really, like, just gassed or tired. And then I get to college, and it is nonstop, just going, going, going. And I was not prepared for that. Like, what was, like, high school practices like for y'all? Like, what was the differences?
I mean, I feel like where I was, so I went to San Augustine High School in San Diego, California. So, we had a really, like, organized, you know, we had a periods. We had 21 periods. So,
really?
I already knew how that was. So I feel like the difference was from like the difference, the different thing was just like how quick it was, you know, not walking at all. You're not talking at all.
Yeah.
You're literally locked in the whole practice.
Yeah.
And everything is literally 100%.
Yeah. And there's no,
I feel like a lot of kids will slack in high school because they know I still get to go home to my mom, get baby, whatever. But up here, it's either if you don't go 100%, you're going back home.
Yeah.
Or you don't go 100%, you're out of here. Like, you literally have to go 100%.
Yeah.
It's like, just no other choice.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would say the biggest change for me is probably just, like, the speed of things. You know, high school, obviously, you're one of the best or the best person on your team. So, you know, things kind of slowed down for you just because you weren't playing against people that were – necessarily like better or like people that would that you like thought as or like saw as a threat every single day. But like here, like even the scout team, they're like all the best players from their high school.
Everybody,
like everyone we have here are just like straight dogs. So like
you really
got to bring that mindset every day. And then obviously Coach Levy's offense, that tempo offense, something different, man.
You got to prepare for that. There's nothing, I mean, really, Smitty's workouts prepared us, but it's even different then. Like, the tempo is, like, right when you catch the ball, right when you get down, you got to bring it right back to the ref, and then it's on to the next play, and on to the next. No break.
That's what it really is, by life, just on to the next.
Nah, for real, especially the college life.
Yeah, just whatever happened last play, drop it.
Yeah.
On to the next.
Yeah. All right, so what do you feel about, since we're talking about, like, practices in football, high school to now, what do you think about the classroom or the academics, high school to now? Is it easier? Is it harder? Is it more hours, less hours?
It's not like, I feel like it's easier because you literally can do it anytime.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's not easy work.
Yeah,
it's hard. It's literally, you got to sit down and do this work.
I see what you mean. It's like a lot more freedom, but, like,
yep.
You still have it's like busy work.
Yep.
Like it's gonna take you a long time.
Yep.
And you just got to like t- time management.
Yeah. Okay.
That's a big tip that I forgot to mention. Like, for new students and like student, it doesn't even matter. You don't even got to be a student athlete. Yeah. Students college in general. Students, right? Like, the time management was the hardest part for me.
Yeah.
Just like knowing when class is, knowing when you have assignments to do, reading the syllabus. Like, it's just, all of it is just so important.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I would just say, I don't think the work is necessarily harder. Just like, I would just say time management.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. It also depends on your major too. What are you majoring in?
I'm in communications right now, but I'm changing mine to criminal profiling. So.
Oh, that's cool. What made you want to like get into that?
You really want to know?
Yeah, I really want to know.
Don't think I'm weird.
I like, I think you're weird.
But you know, like I literally when I first started watching like these type of like series or documentaries, it was like serial killers.
Yeah, like Jeffrey Dahmer, they just came up.
One I watched on Netflix is called Don't Mess With Cats.
I saw that.
So it's basically like this kid, like he grows up and becomes a serial killer. He starts off with cats, posting on YouTube. People trying to track him down. Who is his account posting about cats? Who is he like? Who is this kid? Who is this guy? So when I first like watched it, I was like, I'm really like interested in this. Like, I want to know like, why do they do these things? What makes them do these things?
Yeah.
And like, what's going on in their head, yo? Like, because it's not no typical, like, oh, these are, like, real-life wild things that they're doing.
Yeah.
Low-key, you could, like, minor in, like, a psychology or
that's,
something.
And I think that's what comes with it. I'm going to have to take a psych class, too.
Yeah.
So I'm ready. And then I watched Ted Bundy's little series, and then you got this one that just came out, Jeffrey Dahmer. That was crazy.
So crazy.
But, like, yeah, wild. Those, I just want to know, like, what makes them do these things that they're doing? And it's not just them, it's others too, around the whole world. Like,
it could be one in this room.
Hey,
nah, you never know.
I'm going you first.
Come on. That's why. It's definitely you, baby. Nah, but I'm just a regular business. I don't know what I
Yeah, you can do anything with business too. I'm like,
business too.
Yeah. Weren't you like about to do some like
businessman?
I was in health and exercise science, but then I felt like that was like very like specified, and I don't really know like
exactly like a broader... what
I
want to
do yet. So I just picked something that kind of reached all levels.
Yeah, no, that's definitely valid. G baby, hey, it was nice having you.
Yes,
hopefully, we can have another talk soon.
Yes, sir.
But have any last words? Have any?
How's it feel being a first guest?
Yeah,
first guest
to the podcast. Come on.
But yeah, I had a fun time, man. It was a great talk, you know, my guys. Hopefully I'll be back on here sometime soon.
Sure, I'll see you bright and early Monday morning.
And Sersky, give me three.
Yeah.
You need to hit it right. You gotta hit it.
G baby, 3-on-3. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.